Joining us now for his take on the markets, Ed Francisco of BDO Capital. Hi, Ed. Good morning.
Morning, Mimi.
Okay, so Ed, are you comfortable with the index being at 7,000? I mean, would you say this is fair value and that the market's pricing in, you know, realistic expectations on earnings, the vaccine rollout, and eventually economic recovery?
Yeah, no, I think it's a fair number. Some of the punters were trying to test it and see if it would go below, right? Mm-hmm. But there was already support at the 7,000 level. I think it's a fair number. And then at least once we see more of the announcements and what happens with the vaccine, that will lift it up once we see, I guess, concrete implementation of the vaccination.
Mm-hmm. So what is your short-term and medium-term index call?
Short-term, we will see, I guess, it'll be choppy because we want to see what happens with the vaccine rollout, mm-hmm. right? And then, of course, we're not sure if it will really be 2Q or 3Q where we get the bulk of the medicines. But I think by end of the year, when things stabilize, then we'll see hopefully a 10% increase in the index. I guess that's what everybody's looking at, mm-hmm. In line, again, with the increase in our GDP. Of course, we're coming from a loss, but we're still very optimistic and we have to catch up compared to our neighbors.
Mm-hmm. Ed, just wanted to share, Philippine shares have begun trading. The index right now up by a fifth of 1%, 8 points. We're at 70.73. Tomorrow is a big day. The Bangko Sentral will have its first policy meeting for the year. What kind of language are you hoping to hear from the governor, Ed? I mean, coming from the January inflation print of 4.2%, which essentially overshot all estimates and targets.
Right. Well, in terms of inflation, we hope that they will see, I believe they will say that I think it's really a one-off. And then with the president already putting a cap on, I guess, meat prices, that would help. Inflation, I guess, will go down. I think they will say that, and we're expecting it to normalize mm-hmm. in the next 3-6 months, and that should be good for us. What I like about, anyway, our economic managers, they're really providing the support, so the BSP is there to help in any way. I guess at a certain point, though, it's really not the BSP anyway, but it's more the other incentives that have to come in, but that's where also CREATE bill and these other bills will come in. They will work hand in hand because we do really have a bumpy road ahead.
Mm-hmm.
But at least the monetary side is there, the fiscal side has to help also. And then afterwards, it's really just us going out. Because if they also do not relax it, I heard one comment in one seminar that some of the economic managers were more bullish, but sometimes the IATF and the LGUs themselves that are more careful,
mm-hmm.
and we can't release our people, and therefore people don't go out and consume because they have this fear. So if we get over that, then I think we'll see our economy pick up faster.
Mm-hmm. Are you expecting any more rate cuts from the central bank this year?
They did mention that they're open, you know? Mm-hmm. So rates already are historically low anyway. But I think they're ready to reduce rates. They're even ready also to reduce reserves as needed. The challenge really is there really a demand for additional loans, no, aside from working capital? Because I guess demand, there's already adequate supply capacity. So there really is very little capex left. It's really more for their inventories. Mm-hmm. And some are not even importing yet because of they don't see the demand. So we really have to get the people to be comfortable and consumption to start. Otherwise, even if the businesses are ready, they won't really have to borrow. Mm-hmm. And therefore, the BSP has no, even if they want to really help the companies and the banks, but if the companies are not borrowing, then all of these efforts to reduce the reserves won't really be mm-hmm. beneficial.
Okay, let's now go over some interesting corporate stories, Ed, from yesterday until this morning. Here's one from AirAsia reporting, AirAsia Philippines, the Philippine unit reporting a load factor of 64%, and most of the other units are also doing well. Even Thailand, AirAsia Thailand, already surpassing pre-COVID domestic capacity by 7% in the fourth quarter of last year. Do you think this is a good sign that maybe the travel industry could be near that corner?
Yes, We're very hopeful because, of course, in this K-shaped recovery of the world in general, right? The airline industry is in the bottom, the bottom part. They really need help, airline and tourism. So the sooner, you know, we're comfortable with traveling, even if I guess the international borders are still a little tight, but ideally, we know we should pick up our travel at least domestic. Mm-hmm. I guess one of the things that would help also is this very inconsistent rules, right? If you go to Boracay, you need the PCR test. If you go to other provinces, you only need an antigen. Mm-hmm. You know, when do you need a travel pass? I guess there was a graph that we also, and it's different for by region. It would be nice if they make it consistent. Mm-hmm. It would be nice if there's just one overall pass on the phone. But these are things that can be fixed. And I hope our managers and our mayors and our governors are listening, because if you make it seamless, then of course that would encourage people to travel and that will help the airlines and the tourists. Mm-hmm.
The AirAsia story is really interesting because it represents the travel and tourism.
Yes.
And, you know, we've always been hearing about their plans to list, to IPO here in the Philippines. Yes. So that's one. Recently, we've been reporting about Mon Nissin, the Lucky Me manufacturer, also looking at a $1 billion IPO here in Manila. You know, Ed, you are the IPO king. You arrange a lot of these deals. Talk to us about the IPO pipeline. How strong is the demand? How many names are we realistically looking at this year?
Okay. I won't talk about specific names anyway, because there are publicity guidelines and rules. But in general, we are hoping to see, I think on pipeline, we're seeing at least 4 or 5 large IPOs this year. So it's very strong. The pipeline is thick. It's going to be bigger than last year, surprisingly, because last year I was lucky to be part of the Converge IPO. That was the largest for the country. Mm-hmm. The IPOs this year could potentially be larger. And that's a good sign, right? That means that, you know, that companies are really opening their kimonos and they're willing to bring in foreign investors and local investors. There's growth there. That's a great sign. And then, of course, other countries are also doing as well. But I guess talking to Mon Monzon and Roel Refran of the PSE, they're welcoming these new entrants. And we, on our part, from the investment banking side, we want to help. We're excited. And I think the retail side, you, Mimi, should be buying also once these come out, if you're allowed to buy.
Unfortunately, we cannot trade. But Ed, very curious, 4 to 5 names. Could you give us an idea which sector they belong to? Are they in the retail? Are they in food? Are they in manufacturing? Are they in tech?
In general, of course, we know of 2 or 3 REITs coming out this year, right? This will be good, also very big. So that's exciting. They're strong in their own merits. You know, 2 of them, they've announced another one we're just talking to, but they haven't announced it yet. So we're respecting their privacy. The other 2, anyway. So I guess it's really food and wholesale distribution. I guess that's the better way to look at it. So it's consumer driven still, with some industrial impact, but it's something that we all touch and feel and use.
Okay. We're not even in the blind item yet. Speaking of Converge, whose IPO you also worked on last year, Converge saying that a fiber network in the Philippines, they were able to more than double their network last year, and they're on track to reach 15 million households by 2025. So many investors very happy that finally the share price is beating the IPO price of 1680.
Yes,
the share price is now at 1850. So what is your outlook on Converge?
No, we're very happy with Converge. We're, of course, we have great respect for the founders, the Dennis and Grace Uy. They're continuously hard at work. Continuously talk to them. The rollout is important anyway, because you're right. I mean, tying it a little, right? Globe's numbers, at least in the mobile, their numbers met expectations, but because the mobile side really weakened because people were at home. Mm-hmm. But Globe, PLDT, and Converge, their broadband sales and revenues have really gone up, because Converge is a pure broadband player. That's why their numbers are so good. Mm-hmm. And I think we'll continue to see that, because we're really working at home. We're studying at home, and we don't see that really changing much. So people will continue to use them and they're happy with the service anyway. And that's great. I think their numbers will continue to improve and we'll see their stock price continue to, move up, which is great. Great also for the original investors here. Mm-hmm. And then even for the other telcos, they should be doing well. It's meeting the expectations. And then their broadband sales are really going to help also offset the weakening or the weakened mobile sales.
Mm-hmm. Speaking of Globe, they just came out with net income, their earnings report from fourth quarter and full year of 2020. Net income down 38% in Q4 2020. That's quarter on quarter. But if you look at the full year, they managed to bring in 18.6 billion pesos in net income after tax. That's just down 16%. And here's good news for Globe investors, the shareholders. The Globe Telecom declared a cash dividend of 27 pesos per share. So I guess that's going to make a lot of investors happy. Before I go to the foreign news, we also have this, Justin. Ed, the MSCI rebalancing results are finally out. There's a marginal decrease in the weighting of Philippines in the MSCI EM index of about 0.0064, very small. Two companies are getting an upgrade, ICTSI and another company, Ayala Land, top weight increases in the MSCI Philippines index, while several others are getting weight decreases in the MSCI Philippines index. Ed, are you expecting any drastic moves, market moves, because of this rebalancing, or not so much?
Not so much anyway, but the fact that it's very marginal change is a good sign. Because we're opening later than the competition, the other countries. Mm-hmm. But anyway, I guess once they revisit the next balance and even the PSE is rebalancing their index, we should see changes, but those changes are positive. And at least once these new IPOs come in and when they get part of the index, it will get more foreigners to relook at the Philippines, right? It's very important because, as you mentioned, even the daily stocks trading, foreigners are a smaller percentage, just 20 to 25%, because before it was 50%. But thanks to the strong local investor demand, the volumes are still very strong. And that shows at least the Filipinos are supporting the market. So we're still optimistic.
Okay. Are you also as optimistic on cryptocurrencies? I wanted to get your take on Bitcoin because it surged past $47,000 on Tuesday, a new record, of course, getting a mainstream boost from a blue chip, Elon Musk's Tesla making a $1.5 billion purchase. How seriously should we be looking at this cryptocurrency as a viable investment instrument, Ed?
Yeah. No, I admit that something I don't really understand and appreciate. Maybe Mimi in your generation appreciates it more, because the way I look at it, it's really more like betting in a casino, because I really don't know the underlying asset. So I'm not, maybe my generation is not that comfortable. So I guess if you look at it, as one of your investments, as long as it doesn't break your bank. My advice is about diversified investments. I guess Elon Musk's looking into it adds credibility, but as long as it's not the majority of your holdings, then I guess you can still make money there. Still buy gold, buy other commodities, and of course, support the Philippine capital markets and our Philippine stocks. Okay. I guess that's the best investments you can do.
Okay, it's like investing also in the country. Ed, we've come to the most exciting part of the conversation, the blind item. Talk to us about a stock that you like, you're monitoring closely. Okay. Don't tell us what, just describe. So what do you have for us?
Okay, sure. No, just something to think about, my fellow investors. This is a traded stock, but I guess it's also in distribution and consumption. I won't say what specific industry. Mm-hmm. The stock has gone down a little bit. Think about it this way. During lockdown, it did very well because we were using their products or their whatever they were a lot. No, mm-hmm. The thing is, because of when it opens up, the economy opens up, some people have thought you won't use it as much because you'll be going out some more. My thesis is this: maybe because the vaccine is delayed and we're not going out as soon as we thought, you will still need these products more or longer than expected. And therefore, their profit should be stronger than what analysts are saying. Then that's my tip.
Okay, and the price. If you look at the price chart, is the price looking good?
The price is that's why there's a lot of upside. We believe there's a lot of upside there, and the price has gone down from its peak. So that's okay. why it's a buy.
Undervalued. Okay, thank you very much, Ed. We're just gonna have to guess which stock you were talking about. Thank you for joining us today.
Thank you, Mimi.
Thank you.